Misfund in a library. From Report of the Commander, 7th Expeditionary Force, Andromedan Paleoanthropological Mission. What puzzled our research teams was the suddenness of collapse and the speed of reversion to barbarism in this multi-galactic civilization of the biped race. Obvious causes like war, destruction, plague or invasion were speedily eliminated. Now the outlines of the picture emerge, and the answer makes me apprehensive. Part of the story is quite similar to ours, according to those who know our own prehistory well. On the mother planet, there are early traces of books. This word denotes paleoliterary records of knowledge in representational and macroscopic form. Of course, these disappeared very early, perhaps 175,000 of our Yukals ago, when their increase threatened to leave no place on the planet's surface for anything else. First, they were reduced to micros, and then to supermicros, which were read with the primeval electronic microscopes then extant. But in another Yukal, the old problem was back, aggravated by colonisation on most of the other planets of the local solar system, all of which were producing books in torrents. At about this time, too, their cumbersome alphabet was reduced to mainly consonantal elements, thus, their cumbersome alphabet was reduced to consonantal elements. But this was done to facilitate quick reading, and only incidentally did it cut down the mass of BX, the new spelling, by a full third, a drop out of the bucket. Next step was the elimination of the multitude of separate BX depositories in favour of a single building for the whole civilization. Every home on every inhabited planet had a ferruginous diffuser which tuned in any of the BX at will. This cut the number to about 1 million at a stroke, and the wise men of the species congratulated themselves that the problem was solved. This building, 25 miles square and 2 miles high, was buried in one of the oceans to save land surface for parking space, and so our etymological team is fairly sure that the archaic term library, dates from this period. Within no more than 22 Yukals, story after story had been added till it extended 100 miles into the stratosphere. At this level, cosmic radiation deferaginated the scanning diffusers, and it was realised that another limit had been reached. Proposals were made to extend the library laterally, but it was calculated that in 3 Yukals of expansion, so much of the ocean would be thus displaced that the level of the water would rise 10 feet and flood the coastal cities. Another scheme was worked out to burrow deeper into the ocean bottom, until eventually the library would extend right through the planet like a skewer through a shashlik, a provincial Plutonian delicacy. But it was realised in time that this would only be a momentary palliative. The fundamental advance, at least in principle, came when the representational records were abandoned altogether in favour of punched supermicros, in which the supermicroscopic elements were the punches themselves. This began the epoch of abstract rex, or RX to use the modern term. The great breakthrough came when Megalody finally invented mass-produced punched molecules of any substance. The mass of RX began shrinking instead of expanding. Then Guldberg proved what had already been suspected. Knowledge was not infinite, and the civilization was asymptotically approaching its limits. The flood was levelling off. The RX storage problem was hit another body blow 2 generations later, when Kwilsk used the McGilgi principle to develop the notched electron, made available for use by the new retinogravitic activators. In the ensuing 10 Yukals, a series of triumphant developments wiped the problem out for good, it seemed. 1. Getting below matter level, Schmidt began by notching quanta, an obvious extension of Kwilsk's work, but found this clumsy. In a brilliant stroke, he invented the chipped quantum, with an astronomical number of chips on each one. The RX contracted to one building for the whole culture. 2. Schmidt's pupil, Kujt, even before his master's death, found the chip unnecessary. Out of his work, ably supported by Drunz and Lukten, came the nudged quanta, popularly so called because a permanent record was impressed on each quantum by a simple vectorial pressure occupying no subspace on the pseudo-surface itself. A whole treatise could be nudged onto a couple of quanta, and whole branches of knowledge could, for the first time, be put into a nutshell. The RX dwindled to one room of one building. 3. Finally, but this took another yukal and was technologically associated with the expansion of the civilization to intergalactic proportions. Fuchs and Tseng found that quanta in hyperbolic tensor systems could be tensed into occupying the same spatial and temporal coordinates, if properly pizzicated. In no time at all, a quantic pizzicator was devised to compress the nudged quanta into overlapping spaces, most of these being arranged into wide open areas lying between the outer electrons and the nucleus of the atom, leaving the latter free for tables of contents, illustrations, graphs, etc. All the RX ever produced could now be packed away in a single drawer with plenty of room for additions. A great celebration was held when the RX drawer was ceremoniously installed, and glowing speeches pointed out that science had once more refuted pessimistic croakings of doom. Even so, two speakers could not refrain from mentioning certain misgivings. To understand the nature of these misgivings, we must now turn to a development which we have deliberately ignored so far for the sake of simplicity, but which was in fact going on side by side with the shrinking of the RX. First, as we well know, the RX in the new storage systems could be scanned only by activating the nudged or pizzicated quanta, etc., by means of a code number, arranged as an index to the RX. Clearly, the index itself had to be kept representational and macroscopic, else a code number would become necessary to activate it, or so it was assumed. Secondly, a process came into play of which even the ancients had had presentiments. According to a tradition recorded by Chuk among some oldsters in the remote Los Angeles swamps, the thing started when an antique sage produced one of the paleoliterary BX entitled An Index to Indexes, or XTX, coded as a primitive I to the power of 2. By the time of the supramicros, there were several indices to indices to indices, I to the power of 3, and work had already started on an I to the power of 4. These were the innocent days before the problem became acute. Later, index runs were collected in files and files in catalogues, so that, for example, C to the power of 3, F to the power of 5, I to the power of 4, meant that you wanted an index to indexes to indexes to indexes, which was to be found in a certain file of files of files of files of files of files, which in turn was contained in a catalogue of catalogues of catalogues. Of course, actual numbers were much greater. This structure grew exponentially. The process of education consisted solely in learning how to tap the RX for knowledge when needed. The position was well put indeed in a famous speech by Jizzle to the graduates of the Central Saturnian University, when he said it was a source of great pride to him that although hardly anybody knew anything any longer, everybody now knew how to find out everything. Another type of index, the bibliography, also flourished side by side with the CFI series of the X. This B series was the province of an aristocracy of scholars who devoted themselves exclusively to bibliographies of, well, at the point in history with which we are next concerned, the series had reached B to the power of 437. Furthermore, at every exponential level, some ambitious scholar branched off to a work on a history of the bibliographies of that level. The compilation of the first history of bibliographies, H to the power of 1, is lost in the mist of time. But there is an early chronicled account of a history of bibliographies of bibliographies of bibliographies, H to the power of 3, and naturally H to the power of 436 was itself underway about the time B to the power of 437 was completed. On the other hand, the first history of histories of bibliographies came much later, and this H prime series always lagged behind. It goes without saying that the BHH series, like the CFI series, had to have its own indices, which in turn normally grew into a CFI series ancillary to the BHH series. There were some other but minor developments of the sort. All these index records were representational. Though proposals were made at times to reduce the whole thing to pizzicated quanta, reluctance to take this fateful step long won out. So when the RX had already shrunk to room size, the IX were expanding to fill far more than the space saved. The old library was bursting. one of the asteroids was converted into an annex called the Asteroidal Storage Station. In 13 Yukals, all the ASSs were filled in the original solar system. Other systems selfishly refused to admit the camel's nose into their tent. Under the stress of need, resistance to abstractionizing broke, and with the aid of the new process of co-spatial nudging, the entire mass of Ix was nudged into a drawer no bigger than that which contained the RX themselves. Now this drawer, D to the power of 1, had to be activated by index code numbers itself. More and more scholars turned away from research in the thinner and thinner stream of discoverable knowledge in order to tackle the far more serious problem, how to thread one's way from the Ix to the RX. This specialisation led to a whole new branch of knowledge known as Ariadnology. Naturally, as Ariadnology expanded its RX, its IX swelled proportionately until it became necessary to set up a sub-branch to systematise access from the Ix to the RX of Ariadnology itself. This, the Ariadnology of Ariadnology, was known as A to the power of 2, and by the time of the collapse, the field of A to the power of 5 was just beginning to develop, together with its appropriate Ix, plus the indispensable BH8 series, of course. The inevitable happened in the course of a few yukals. The Ix of the second code series began to accumulate in the same ASSs that had once been so joyfully emptied. Soon, these Ix were duly abstractionized into a second drawer, D to the power of 2. Then it was the old familiar story. The library filled up, the ASSs filled up. Around 10,000 yukals ago, the first artificial planet was created, therefore, to hold the steadily mounting agglomeration of Ix drawers. Around 8,000 yukals ago, a number of artificial planets were united into pseudo-solar systems for convenience. By the time of Yukal 2738 of our own era, for we are now getting into modern times, the artificial pseudo-solar systems were due to be amalgamated into a pseudo-galaxy of drawers when the catastrophe struck. This tragic story can be told with some historical detail, thanks to the work of our research teams. It began with what seemed a routine breakdown in one of the access lines, from D to the power of 57 times 103 to D to the power of 47 times 107. A bibliothecal mechanic set out to fix it as usual. It did not fix. He realised that a classification error must have been made by the Ariadnologist who had worked on the last pseudo-solar system. Tracing the misnudged quanta involved, he ran into C to the power of 11, F to the power of 73, I to the power of 15. Laboriously tracing through, he found a note. This X class has been replaced by C to the power of 32, F to the power of 7, I to the power of 10, 4 brachiogravitic endoragnathans, and C to the power of 22, F to the power of 64, I to the power of 3, for iliurophenylophenylitic exorthoragnathans. Tracing this through in turn, he found that they led back to the original C to the power of 11, F to the power of 73, I to the power of 15. At this point, he called in the district bibliothecal technician, who pointed out that the misjudged sequence could be restored only by reference to the original RX. Through the area bibliothecal engineer, an emergency message was sent to the chief himself, Mulville Dewey Smith. Without hesitation, his bibliothecal excellency pressed the master button on his desk and queried the Ix system for knowledge, universal, all RX drawers, location of. To his stunned surprise, the answer came back. See also C to the power of 11, F to the power of 73, I to the power of 15. Frantically, he turned dials, nudged quanta, etc. But it was no use. Somewhere in the galaxy-sized flood of Ix drawers was the one and only drawer of RX, the one that had once been installed with great joy. It was somewhere among the indexes, bibliographies, histories of bibliographies, etc., etc. A desperate physical search was started, but it did not get very far, breaking down when it was found that no communication was possible in the first place without reference to the knowledge stored in the RX. As the entire bibliothecal staff was diverted for the emergency, breakdowns in the access lines multiplied and tangled until whole sectors were disabled, rendering further cooperation even less possible. the fabric of this biped civilization started falling apart. The final result you know for my final report. Rehabilitation plans will be sent tomorrow. Yours, Yuthvrg, Commander. Handwritten memo. This report received L43102. File it under M to the power of 42, A to the power of 8, E to the power of 39, TG. Handwritten memo. You must be mistaken. There is no M to the power of 42, A to the power of 8, E to the power of 39, replaced by WM23, A72, E34 duo-denominated trade reports. LN. Handwritten memo. You dumb fool, you've bungled again. Now you've got to refer to the RX to straighten out the line. Here's the correction number, stupid.